Perhaps more than any technology, AI raises ethical questions. Here to help us answer some of them is Dr. Olya Kadina.
Good afternoon. It's a great honor to be with you here today. The theme, the age of AI, often invokes speculative future narratives about the utopian or dystopian powers of AI, of AI that will either cure diseases and solve climate change, or, to the contrary, that will put humans out of job and end humanity as we know it. But in order to understand how to build sustainable human-AI collaborations that work not just for us humans, but that also preserve our planet, it's important to look beyond the hype, to demystify AI. The age of AI is not just about promises of technological progress. It's about how our society and our planet get profoundly transformed through AI's development and use. People who, on the one hand, develop AI technologies, but on the other, get profoundly transformed through its use, because AI helps to change our goals, practices, and even our moral standards. And AI is also about the environment, because AI is not in the cloud. It's very much material. It's in the chips and the data centers, building and operating which require a lot of earth minerals, water, and energy. This not only harms the environment when AI is developed or used, but also pollutes the planet after AI-infused gadgets are discarded. By this token, AI is not only about the technologies, but also about the developers and users in cultural and environmental settings. Together, they produce AI as a complex socio-technical system, where the human, technological, and the world environment co-produce each other. And any attempt to develop AI that is responsible has to seriously consider that challenge. As we stand at the brink of a new academic year, nothing illustrates this idea better than the introduction of ChatGPT that took the world by storm this year. Its introduction was accompanied by so much hype that sometimes it's difficult to understand what really is at stake with this technology. Taking education as a context, while some profess that ChatGPT will destroy the value of academic integrity and be the end of education as we know it, a lot of people really hope that ChatGPT will alleviate many burdensome tasks and will actually help to achieve new potential and creativity. Now, when I tested ChatGPT as it came out, I was impressed by how human-like its output looked. But I also noticed that it suffers from similar important limitations as the older versions of the language models. Importantly, ChatGPT does not understand language the way people do. Instead, it processes words as a statistical pattern and predicts the answers most likely to resemble its training data. But since the training data of ChatGPT was pretty much the scraped internet, on top of algorithms, human data labelers, as we now know the underpaid workers from Kenya, manually filtered through the results of ChatGPT to make sure that it does not produce results that look unethical or illegal, and make sure that its content looks more human-like. Regardless of these very much human and technological efforts, ChatGPT still produces inaccurate or misleading information and exhibits different forms of bias. So, how helpful in education can it actually be? I started experimenting with ChatGPT early on in my classes, and the students loved it. They were fascinated by the speed of text and code generation, ease of use, and found it quite helpful in constructing the logic of their texts and their presentations, overcoming the fear of the blank page. It was also my students who pointed to me a potential inclusion benefit of using ChatGPT in class. According to them, it helps non-native speakers to formulate their thoughts faster and in smoother language. At the same time, The students were very quick to spot the misleading perception of intelligence, to see that language models are not about truth or facts, but about likelihood and approximation. They did not easily trust the results of ChatGPT, as it kept, for instance, generating fake academic references, and complained about how much work it takes to actually make ChatGPT work in their educational assignments. Now, I also expanded the academic integrity policy in my classes to underscore the proactive responsibility of students instead of a sort of policing attitude from the teachers. And it's not just about class. It also impacts the larger academic community. As a co-editor-in-chief to a new TU Delft-based Journal of Human-Technology Relations, we also had to adjust authors' guidelines, specifying that authorship, even in the age of generative AI, still requires uniquely human responsibility and accountability. So we do not allow listing ChatGPT as a co-author. That said, what should we do about ChatGPT in class and research now? While universities across the globe still struggle for an answer to this question. Now, based on my experiences, I'm leaning towards informed and pragmatic use, guided by specific educational objectives. This requires not only strong institutional leadership in training teachers and students on how to use this tool responsibly, but also invites teachers to review what they want to achieve in their classes, and correspondingly review the assessment methods to test for that. A critical use of ChatGPT forces us to consider whether it's necessary to use this tool at all, because training large language models costs huge amounts of energy. And for every 20 prompts that users exchange with ChatGPT, the data centers consume a half-liter bottle of drinking water that is polluted afterwards. So in choosing to use it in class, we need to consider different types of costs. With its complex political and environmental arrangements, ChatGPT is a fitting example of a socio-technical system where each of the elements co-produce each other and demonstrates that effective human-AI collaborations are not straightforward. Now, the good news is you've come to the right place to be proactive about the responsible design and use of AI systems. TU Delft is positioned well to develop AI sensitive to the values of humans and the environment. To mention just a few examples, Mirta Tillman's work showcases what it takes to establish trust in human-AI collaborations. Odette Scharenborg directs effort at reducing gender bias in automatic speech recognition systems. And Jun Salu works on reducing the carbon footprint in AI systems. Or the AI Demos Lab, co-directed by Nazli Gina and myself with a team of 5 PhD researchers, where across the disciplines of philosophy and design, we investigate how AI technologies such as deepfakes, social media, and profiling algorithms influence democratic practices, and how to develop AI systems that promote plurality and constructive discussions. But more important than the faculty, it's the students who will be the defining force in an attempt to build AI as complex socio-technical systems. Understanding why we need to develop new AI technology and what it takes to do so responsibly should be a starting point of any project, because it might make one aware that perhaps it's not necessary at all to put yet new another technology on the market. Or it might alert one to the trade-offs and moral dilemmas that very often accompany AI development and use. However difficult, such investigations that confront one with uncomfortable truth is a must in a quest to develop AI systems that promote values of people and the environment with care and justice. This also helps to avoid alarmist narratives propagating utopian or dystopian scenarios, and instead allows focusing on how AI is not somewhere there in the cloud or in the distant future, but very much here and in the material ways helps to weave the canvas of our society. Studying at TU Delft will equip you with the critical mindset and the instruments to weave this future now. Let's shape AI responsibly together. Thank you.